Hey everybody, this is Perch. As you know, I'm a longtime X-Men fan. I continue to have my unbroken run of the X-Men, but the series has reached that point. It has in the past, but it's reached that point where you're collecting the issues, but you have zero passion for what's going on in the issues, and you kind of flip through them hoping that something there is going to kind of ignite those passions and that it's going to remind you of kind of the book that you committed to collecting, but we're not there, and feels pretty far off from there. And you know, people will tell me, it's like, well, why don't you stop? And yeah, that's a choice everybody has to make. And for me, it's we're it's getting close to that point, because what starts to kind of crystallize in your mind is you say to yourself, hey, I'm a collector, I want an unbroken run. But if the comic doesn't resemble the comic you started collecting, if it's completely shifted, then you already have a broken run. The comic itself has broken itself. So that's kind of where we are today. And hey, it's an opportunity for somebody else to start a run of the X-Men loving this version of it. It's fine. Again, it's Marvel's book. They can do what they want with it. But you know, it's. It's not fun, I would say. And so I've got this viewer mail here from somebody talking about X-Men Red. Now, if you haven't been following along, X-Men Red, there was previously an X-Men Red back during the blue and gold bits. That was written by Tom Taylor. It had Jean Grey in it. And I don't even know where to begin with that series, actually. But this version of X-Men Red, is kind of a spiritual successor to Sword. And it's still written by Al Ewing. And it's basically the stories of the X-Men. Although in this case, it's Storm. I think Sunspot kind of hangs out there. Magneto is there now. And the Araku mutants on the terraformed Mars planet, which is a mutant homeworld of the solar system. It's not for me. I guess I'll just put it that way. I'm not sure what it is, but is this title meant to be science fiction? Is it meant to be, mutant action? It's like it's a very odd book in a lot of ways. We're three issues in, so maybe it's unfair to say that, but the three issues have been odd. The one thing I'm sure it's not is what Jordan White promised, which was a huge build for Storm in 2021, kind of the last year and a half. Marvel had been promising, hey, we're going to do something really big with Storm. There's kind of a setup in the giant size books with Jonathan Hickman that really didn't feel like it went anywhere. It told a story, but it I don't know. It didn't. It was confusing what the plan was, and it was tied into Children of the Vault, sort of. But anyway, it didn't make a whole lot of sense. And on the other end, they had her become the queen or regent of Mars, president of a planet. Except that doesn't really mean anything. You could say that as like a big deal, but it kind of goes along with the entire X-Men universe saying the planet of Mars is now the center of the solar system. That's the home planet, not Earth. It's Mars now, and they announced that and they said it, but who cares? All the action still happens on Earth. Like nobody believes any of that. None of that means anything. The Eternals are coming to do this whole AVXVE whatever crossover, and it's happening. I mean, they're coming to Earth. The action's all happening on Earth. All the characters on Earth. I don't know. But this is one of those things you could say it, but it doesn't make it true. Kind of moments. But anyway, let me get to this mail real quick, and we can talk about it. It says, "Hey Perch, so let's just cut to the chase. The X-Men are a hot mess. Al Ewing is writing X-Men Red. Immortal X-Men is written by Kieran Gillen. And Vanilla X-Men is written by Jerry Duggan." Vanilla X, they just put it in there. Vanilla X-Men. Anyway, three books that feel completely different and unrelated. Now, pausing right here real quick, that's not necessarily a bad thing. I think if you had three books that have different tones to them, that were accomplishing different things, had different audiences, that would be fine. Of the three, the Vanilla X-Men is probably intended to be the most familiar to long-term X-Men fans. I think that's the intent. It doesn't do that, but you know, I, that's at least what it's trying to do, I guess. But anyway, back to the mail. Before I get there, so there's nothing, I don't mind the fact that these books have different tones to them, and done correctly, that would be pretty, that could be pretty cool. It could all, even done incorrectly, as long as you had a couple books there that made sense, and then a couple books that just worked for you, great. That could be a decent strategy with the X-Men. The hard part is, it's hard to tell who any of these books are for. They're all odd in their own ways. It's puzzling. Anyway, sorry, continue with the mail. But the topic at hand is X-Men Red number 3, one of the absolute worst comics I've ever read. Cable gets resurrected because death means less than a restaurant getting your order wrong, and he chooses to be resurrected with the techno-organic virus. Cable has spent the better part of his entire existence fighting the TO virus and to remove it, but now he treats it like a tattoo. That was stupid. And this is part of the resurrection stuff that I find bizarre in general. And I think the writers have kind of explained it away of people owning their hardships or owning their handicaps, except like Karma, got a leg lopped off. Why would they resurrect her without a leg? Like that's not really, you know, embracing your handicap. That, like, you know, Dick Villain cut off her leg. Like that's, I don't know what are you doing there? Like, you could resurrect, and it's clearly like Mystique resurrects Destiny younger so they can have hotter, not icky sex. But you know, meanwhile, you're willing to resurrect, you know, people blind, all this other. If this is supposed to be a message of, you know, embrace your handicaps, that, you know, we're accessible to you're not accessible to everyone, though. You've got a resurrection machine. You've got people whose powers can fly them around. You know, stop saying, hey, we need this. It's kind of the same thing. Stop saying we need this book to be relatable, and that's why we're going to completely change the personality of these characters. And Cable, who's had this this virus problem for his entire life, now is like, I am embracing my... This is not in line with the character. It's dumb, and it's not relatable. You know, I've got a friend as a child has a handicap. It's hard on the parents. They've embraced it. They're bringing that kid up as best they can and giving him a good life. And good for them. That's admirable. It'd be far harder, both the parents and the child with a handicap, to have to, you know, it's just your life is tougher. And to give that support is great. And to acknowledge that support in a comic book is fine too. It's great. But, you know, again, in a world where you've got resurrection protocols and terraformed planets and all this other stuff, you're not as relatable as you think. Just saying, hey, yeah, we drew this character the same way as this person, it does not work. And in fact, in many ways, I think it's insulting. If somebody had a missing arm, or, you know, a diabetes, or you know, any number of things, somebody going through cancer, etc., talking about, hey, we acknowledge you. Meanwhile, the character could be completely reborn to a new, fresh, healthier body. But because we want to acknowledge you, we're going to reinsert the problem that was going on. I think more offensive than helpful, but be that as it may. Anyway, back to the mail. Cable, we got to do that. Then Tarn gets jobbed out on Mars because Ewing wanted Magneto to join the Araku Council after he just left Krakoa. Because he was on the Krakoa Council, now he's on the Araku Council, I guess. I don't know. Again, that doesn't really fit with the writing of the character from, you know, what Killian Gillen was doing, but nothing matters, so fine. And then he gets beaten by Al Ewing, unable to understand how Iska the Unbeaten's powers work. Sunspot just casually makes a bet with her, and she doesn't accept it, but somehow he renders her unable to counter this master strategy. She can't lose. That doesn't mean she always wins. She can just refuse. yeah, that scene was really stupid. Basically, they're trying to promote up Sunspot, which is good, as Sunspot's an interesting character, and I think it's cool to do more with him. But in trying to make him a super clever player, he basically goes, I'm going to make a bet with Iska, a bet that she, that would be a dumb bet to take, basically. And she's like, but I can't be beaten. And so she kills Sunspot, as I recall, but it doesn't matter. Again, he goes to the resurrection tube. But that's not how it works. She doesn't have to take every fight. She's not trapped into constantly accepting every challenge. If her mutant power is she can't be beaten, which is a dumb mutant power in general, then the writer has to be thoughtful about how, he or she inserts her into stories. That's a dumb moment. Unfortunately, I know from, behind the scenes stuff that this moment was, workshopped by a bunch of people on the X-Slack who all thought it was super genius, which it was not. It doesn't make any sense. Anyway, the mail concludes with, sorry for the rant, but Christ, that was a shit comic. The X-Men were in their current states, not for me. It's hard to tell what they're doing. If you're enjoying yourself, honestly, more power to you. I'm glad you are. Full up glad you're enjoying these books. Somebody needs to. I don't think if you enjoy them, I don't think you're stupid. I don't think I don't think you're wrong even. For you, you're not wrong, but you're wrong for me. I'll put it that way. I don't understand the end game here. And where I keep coming back to with the X-Men is that. Where does this go? Let's assume for the moment, and it's a safe assumption, that 10 years from now, there's still going to be X-Men comics, right? They're still going to be cranking them out. The value of the IP is high enough that, they're still going to be making this stuff. At that point, the MCU will have rolled out a couple X-Men movies. We'll have these characters kind of inserted into things. There'll be some Disney Plus shows. You'll see the X-Men on the screen. So there's going to be comics. There's going to be this representation of the X-Men. Where is it going to be in 10 years? Are they still going to be doing this Krakoa Island stuff in 10 years? Are they going to try and go weirder and more obscure with the X-Men? Are they going to try to, have the characters are we trying to make the X-Men more like Doom Patrol, where it's completely, nonsensical in some areas? I love Doom Patrol. But again, I think the X-Men was a superhero book. So, where is this headed? Or does at some point, we figure out how to do the Moira snap and the world just goes back to how it was, and you get straightforward stories of the mutants are hunted and feared and they're trying to make their way and save the world that hates them. And is that where it's going? It's really hard to tell. I always think it's dangerous when a comic company gets itself into a position where really the only outcome you can see is reboot the universe. Feels like that's where we are, though. It feels like we're in reboot the universe land. I don't know how you come around from this. Now, I'm not a clever creative writer, so I don't necessarily need to. But some clever creative writer is going to have to, unpack and unwind this at some point. And I mean, maybe it's just a 12-issue series where it's like, we call it the damage control. I guess that is a comic already, but maybe you have this 12-issue event. It's like, hey, we're going to, scorch the earth there in our Mars, and the island's gone, it's sunk, and the resurrection stuff bad, and a mutant came around and mind-wiped everybody, or maybe Scarlet Witch showed up and said, no more bullshit, what's that moment look like? And so that's my question to you, the people reading this. In 10 years, where are we? Is this still going on? Have they reset it? If they've reset it, how do they do it? What did that look like? I'm curious to get your takes on it. Anyway, thank you for the mail, and we'll keep on trying here. somehow. Thanks for listening.